another brand new project that's kind of exciting to us. I'm not sure how many of you know, but there seems to be a lot of interest in corn these days. Pioneer and DuPont are both investing heavily in Western Canada, and just down the highway here, a few weeks ago, we had the grand opening of the Pioneer Ultra Low Heat Unit corn breeding facility in Lethbridge here. So they have projected acres of somewhere in between 7 to 10 million acres of corn in Western Canada in the next 15 years, which just sounds absolutely absurd. And I think I would have said that too before I grew some dryland corn this year. I mentioned earlier we were at 50% moisture, and I'm pretty amazed at how great this corn looks. So this project was funded sort of last minute this year, and we were scrambling to get planters in place. So I actually have to thank the Monsanto folks for planting this. This is a completely dryland spot right here. We didn't irrigate it at all, but it's agronomy that we're trying to tie in. So we have the breeding facility here. We're excited about seeing, you know, we always have to couple good agronomy with breeding to make it work. So we've put in a number of locations across southern Alberta to start, and we're looking at things like row spacing, planting populations, crop sequencing, you know, what's the best rotation, and basically how do we fit dryland corn into our production systems here in, well, to start off in southern Alberta because we have the heat, but the plan is to move it as, you know, they're actually doing breeding work in Edmonton as well. So you'll see often in the highway they're already growing it for grazing and such, but we're very much focused on the actual grain corn side of it. So no silage, no grazing. We want to do grain corn. So we've got a corn header ordered up for our plot combine, and next year we'll have our own corn planters. And I think that some of the neat things will be how to really incorporate it into a semi-arid area. So what do you guys think some of the challenges might be with corn grown in this area? Moisture is an obvious one, yeah. I think frost is my biggest concern. So that can we get it to maturity by that late frost, that September frost that we tend to have? What else? So let's talk about that right now. Mike, do you want to maybe just give an overview of what you know about corn and the disease risks and issues for other crops, if you don't mind?
Sure. Yeah. Fusarium is a good place to start, I think. Fusarium graminearum, so there's a number of Fusarium species that cause disease on a number of our crops. Fusarium in small seeded, small grain cereals like wheat and barley, you can get root rots due to Fusarium. You can get foot rots, so diseases that set up right at the soil line or the crown of the plant. And then the spores can also get up onto the head, and if that happens when the flowers are open, you can get head blight or head scab. And so that's become a big issue in the prairies, because the head scab problem, when it gets into the grain, the fungus produces a mycotoxin that is poisonous, and so it creates a lot of issues. It also causes the kernels to be kind of shrunken and pale looking, and so there's a yield decrease with the shrunken kernels, there's a downgrading if there's too many Fusarium damaged kernels, and then the mycotoxin factor sometimes makes it create some market acceptability issues. So Fusarium in grains is a real issue. Now what does corn have to do with that? Well, the most aggressive pathogen with respect to head scab is Fusarium graminearum, and it's actually a regulated pest in Alberta. And where corn comes into play is that Fusarium graminearum loves corn as a host. And so oftentimes you'll see graminearum colonizing the lower part of the corn stalk, so within the first node or two. And then it, in the fall, it produces a lot of overwintering structures that then release spores in the springtime. So corn residue can be a big reservoir for Fusarium graminearum spores. And it's been documented in the United States and part of the eastern prairies that corn in rotation with small grain cereals and in combination with conducive weather conditions can really drive Fusarium graminearum to become a real problem with respect to head scab in wheat. So that's the connection. Is it possible to manage Fusarium germinierum, or is this going to shut down all our industries? Like, do we need to be pressing the panic button here? I don't think anyone needs to panic. This disease has shown up in the Midwest, and we've seen it, you know, established very quickly in Manitoba, and it's moved across Saskatchewan. It's been in southern Alberta since the late 80s or 90s. It's definitely caused some issues, and it's a very difficult disease to manage. So it's not to be taken lightly, but yes, we'll still be able to produce cereal crops and corn, even with Fusarium becoming established in our production areas. So it's definitely something to consider and be aware of, that the more corn we have in rotation, the more chance that we'll see more Fusarium head scab in our small grain cereals. Can I jump to a couple other diseases in corn?
Absolutely, yeah.
Bacterial diseases. We don't normally expect to see a lot of bacterial disease issues when we're at 25% normal moisture and, you know, 125% heat. So hot, dry conditions that bacteria really can't survive very well in those conditions. We've seen bacterial leaf stripe in wheat this year. We've seen Goss's wilt in corn this year, which is a bacterial caused by a bacterial pathogen, and we've seen bacterial stalk rot in corn. Now, why are we seeing all these bacterial diseases even in a hot, dry year? The reason is that when the canopy closes and there's irrigation, there's a microclimate that can be created where these bacteria can survive and cause some disease. Now, we haven't seen any epidemics of bacterial diseases because the environment just isn't going to drive them to, you know, really spread throughout the whole field. But here's an example of bacterial stalk rot. When you have a pivot irrigation going over the corn, you're going to get a lot of rain accumulating where the leaves attach to the stalk, and it can stay trapped in there all day and all night. And so then, you know, there's dew at the night. And so where the water pools here at the junction of the leaf and the stem, that's where the bacteria have, there's a microclimate there where the bacteria can survive. And so we've seen bacterial stalk rot in association with this part of the stem where the leaf attachment is and where the water pools. Anybody have any idea why we'd see Goss's wilt this year?
Hail.
Heavy dew.
So heavy dew is a big part of it. Thanks for coughing out the word hail, Ken. So storms often are a big predisposing factor for diseases to get going. And so the bacterial pathogens, when the leaves become torn or shredded, they have a really huge target there then to initiate disease. The bacteria, unlike fungi, they can't directly penetrate the leaf. They can't force themselves in. So they have to either go through natural openings. And so there's either stomata all speckled along the surface of the leaves that when those are open, the bacteria can get in. Or at the margin of the leaf, the hydathodes, where transpiration, where the water's being released. So the bacteria can get in through natural openings, but boy, when there's wind-driven hail or even heavy rain or wet sand, you know, blowing, sandblasting of the leaves, those little wounds or big wounds create just all kinds of opportunities for bacteria. So we have seen a couple of fields that have Goss's wilt. We've seen example of bacterial stalk rot. And basically all the common diseases or diseases that are established here, we've seen them this year. Just that we often, I guess what I'd say is that in most cases, there's bigger issues to worry about than disease, like drought. So yes, they're out there, and yes, we need to keep an eye on them, and yes, there's been fields protected with fungicides so that we don't have undue losses, but I think the real story is the moisture and the heat this year.
Any questions for Mike on any of that?
Is there zero tolerance on corn seed with your plant, or for Fusarium and other diseases that can be carried on the seed?
Yeah, it's a good question. So his question is there a zero tolerance for Fusarium on corn seed? The answer to that question is any seed is not allowed to have a regulated disease pest on it. So if there was some Fusarium on corn seed, it would be regulated. Now, normally in corn, we see a stalk rot due to Fusarium. We don't see a lot of ear. It can get up on the ear, and you can see ear rot as well. But usually in corn, the Fusarium issue is at the stalk, and it'll cause lodging, or if there's a real serious lesion that girdles the stem, you know, it can affect the ability for the plant to move water up and nutrients and photosynthates down. But generally speaking, corn seed isn't probably going to have loads of fusarium on it, because in this plant, the disease gets established in the lower part of the stem. But the answer to the question is yes. If according to the way the act is written, it says for purposes of propagation, you can't have a regulated pest on the seed or the tuber or the transplant or whatever you're using to propagate plants. You can't have a regulated disease on it. So it's a much bigger issue in the small grain cereals because of the issue with graminearum getting up onto the head and then being on the seed.
Who enforces the regulation that you have? Somebody's taken out of your corn, it's healthy or not?
Yeah, so...
But you have to do it yourself.
So the regulations are enforced locally at the level of municipality. So the ag fieldman is the person by virtue of his office that would have authority to enforce. Obviously the ag fieldman can't go around and test every seed lot that's in his county. We rely on producers to be aware of what issues there are and to have seed tests done when needed. We certainly would recommend seed testing small grain cereals for fusarium, because if Fusarium graminearum isn't a major issue on your farm, you certainly don't want to bring it in on the seed. In southern Alberta, I think it's fairly common. I don't think establishing it here is the issue anymore. I think it's already established. So having some on seed, from a disease management perspective, having a little bit of it on the seed isn't a major issue in southern Alberta, probably. But the act isn't very forgiving in the way it's written. So we should test seed, and if there's fusarium on it, we shouldn't use it. Alan? I'm just kidding. Feel free to chime in though here, because I know you have a lot of expertise on this topic. The question is balancing irrigation with Fusarium head blight. So that's a great question, because Fusarium head blight, you have to have open flowers and the spores getting up into the open flowers, and you have to have available moisture. So if we can time our irrigation so that there isn't a lot of free moisture at that anthesis stage or when the flowers are open, we're creating an environment that makes it really hard for Fusarium to get going. So if we can avoid flowering during that week to 2 week period where the flowers are open, where the anthers are extruded on the heads, that can play to our advantage. So timing irrigation that you load up the soil profile just before anthesis and then waiting for flowering to finish and then irrigate after is ideal. In a really dry year, that may be hard to do because that's a very critical time for the plant to have enough moisture. Alan, did you have more to say about that?
No, you got it right. Usually around here, I wrote a little bug sheet when I was still working for irrigation division, and it was based on soil texture. How do you fill up the profile and ensure that the crop gets enough moisture during that critical moisture requirement time? And the only soil texture that couldn't do it over 1 week was the loamy sands, but the rest of the soil textures, you can fill up the profile just before the crop goes into flowering, and that moisture you have in the soil can carry through that period. It's about 50 to 60 millimeters required for flowering period. And then what Mike said, having many tools in the toolbox, for instance, thinking ahead by manipulating seeding rate so that you can narrow the window of irrigation, so you don't have tillers. When you have more tillers coming out because of lower seeding rate, then you prolong the flowering period, and that works against you with irrigation management. Yeah.
Thanks, Alan.
Yeah.
Anything else?
Well, I'll ask you a quick question then, Mike.
Okay.
We kind of have fusarium management strategies in place for cereals, like we were just talking about with irrigation scheduling and fungicides and such. What are some of the management strategies in corn production? And since you mentioned that it's more of a root disease versus a head disease, and you can't really play with tillers since it's...
So that's a great question, Ken. We don't really have a lot of management strategies to talk about in corn per se, because Fusarium graminearum is rarely an economic problem for corn production, especially in silage corn production where you're taking, you know, you're taking a crop off at an earlier stage. So in most cases, you don't see a lot of yield loss due to Fusarium colonization of the roots. And so, you know, it's not economic to apply fungicides. Mm-hmm. We don't really have a sheet that talks a lot about Fusarium resistance or tolerance in corn. So, yeah, I don't have much for that one.
Okay.
But that's a really good question, and I'll maybe put some more thought to that. Because we don't see a lot of yield damage due to Fusarium in corn, we don't really get a lot of questions about that.
And Mike, from African experience, it's easy to clean Fusarium-infected cobs during harvesting.
Okay.
Yeah, in Africa, it's very easy to clean the healthy corn cob from unhealthy cob.
So a lot of the surveys that have been taking place in the past has obviously highlighted irrigated areas as higher risk for Fusarium, and if we're trying to expand into the dryland areas, do you expect that there would be really that much risk in introducing the pest? Or
yeah, so there's three major factors that will lead to the establishment of Fusarium. One is growing of highly susceptible hosts. Two is growing those in close rotation, and three is lots of moisture, especially for the small grain cereals at heading. So growing things like durum wheat, where we really don't, in that market class, we really don't have any good tolerance or resistance to Fusarium. Growing corn, which is also a really good host. And then if we, you know, have either a lot of moisture due to irrigation or in rain-fed situations, those three things will really drive that organism to become really well established and to cause some significant issues, particularly in the small grains. So, you know, if we're thinking about increasing the acres of corn, it would be similar to if we were going to increase the acres of durum. Those are two crops that are highly susceptible to Fusarium, and so they could cause an increase in the levels, the overall levels that we see. And the reason that's I think a significant issue is that when you have a lot of Fusarium inoculum in a field, it doesn't only just affect that field. It's going to affect neighbors in a surrounding area. So it's kind of a community disease. And so the more susceptible crops we have, and especially if they're in close rotation and what conducive weather, we're going to see Fusarium become the same kind of an issue here as it's become in Manitoba and parts of Saskatchewan, where it's a real significant management issue. It could become the biggest management issue for small grain cereals. It's that important of a pathogen. So we've been fortunate in Alberta. We've kind of watched it coming from east to west, and we've had time to put management practices in place and to try to delay its spread. But it's a pathogen that could certainly move and colonize all the cereal production areas of the province, and in likelihood it probably will do that over time, but we'd certainly like to slow it down or stop it as much as we can.
One more comment, then. I know we've been working together on a leaf spot disease with Randy Kuchner, looking at timing of fungicide applications. I think that our breeders have done a really great job in the cereals for developing good leaf disease resistance. Did you see that where they were talking about that there was really no major reduction in leaf spot control by spraying at the head blight timing? Is that maybe a bit of a shift possibly coming?
I think it is. So even in situations in the black soil zone where disease levels for leaf spots in wheat were higher, so this is the third year that we've done the project, and we haven't had really high disease pressures in the brown soil zones, but in the black soil zones they've had significant disease pressure. Even in those situations, there was no significant difference between one application at the head timing as opposed to the flag leaf timing. So for leaf spots, the best time that we know to apply is when the flag leaf has emerged, then we protect that green tissue. For head blight, we have to spray when the anthers are extruded, so during the head timing. And so the question was asked, what if I wait till head timing to control both leaf spots and Fusarium? Is there going to be a yield penalty or an economic loss? And in the 3 years of study that we've done in Alberta, Saskatchewan, and Manitoba, two sites in each province, the answer is there's no significant yield penalty to protecting at the anthesis timing. So there's still the results this year to come out, and then sorting through the data, because anytime you do field research, there's complicating factors like hail and drought and disease pressure and stuff like that. So once the numbers are all sorted out, we'll have an official kind of release. But what we're seeing now is a trend that, yeah, you can, in most cases, you can do one fungicide application at the head timing, and that's going to give you the biggest bang for your buck. Now, we did see more protection and higher yields with two apps. So if you apply it flag leaf and you apply it heading, those always showed the best disease control and the highest yields. But in most cases, it wasn't significant, and the second app didn't necessarily pay for itself in the yield benefit. The most economic was the one application at the heading. So stay tuned for more on that, but that's just as Dune Pauly says, don't make life-changing decisions based on what I just said. This is preliminary data, but just to give you an indication of where the data are taking us at this point, that's kind of where it's leaning.
Corn's actually pretty drought tolerant, and I think this is proof of it right here. To me, what's going to be really tricky is getting this fit into a zero-till situation in southern Alberta. Like, I think about, you know, corn is very finicky. We want to have the right placing of plants. And as you walk along the plots, what we're doing is looking at 20-inch row spacing and 30-inch row spacing. 30 is more traditional. But you know what? A lot of the corn grown in other places is all under conventional systems, all tillage. And getting just the exact right plant spacing, precision planting, is really important. But for us, and looking at experiences based on South Dakota, which is sort of similar, hot and dry areas. You know, Dwayne Beck himself told me that he thinks what's going to work best under dryland situations is a 20-inch row spacing with 20,000 kernels per acre. So that's what this study is designed to do. You can see that on a higher plant population, you're going to run out of water and it's not going to be able to fill the corn. So that's the whole point of this project. And we'll take a few minutes just to walk along, and you can take a look at the different plant populations, focus in on sort of the spacing, the thickness of the stalks, the leaves. You can actually pick out pretty significant differences on how it's doing under this stressed environment. So, spacing at 30,000 kernels per acre, which is probably too high. You can even notice the cobs, the differences. And then if we find one, so this is that 20 inch at 20,000 kernels. So this is the one that researchers expect to actually do the best under a dryland situation. But we're going to find out.
This is for grain, Ken? Or
this is for grain, yeah.
Would it be different than if you're for silage?
Absolutely. Yeah, different response curves. So silage, you have a much more everything, nutrient rich, moisture rich, more higher production zone. So typically 35,000 kernels per acre on silage. We're expecting dry land to be much lower. I've heard farmers going as low as 16,000 kernels. So it's, you know, coming up with the right seeding rate that will give you a crop despite the moisture limiting factors. Does that make sense?
Is the seed the same, the varieties are the same whether you're a silage or
not typically, because you know, southern Alberta Lethbridge area has around on average 2200, 2300 corn heat units, and as you move to Medicine Hat, it's as high as 2500 heat units. But on silage, they could be growing a 2600 heat unit variety, depending on where they are and the fact that they don't necessarily have to go all the way to maturity as well. The industry, the seed industry. Yeah. And they've been adapting corn. So obviously they want to sell their traits, and they're only going to do that if farmers make money. So I think that they have projections that this is going to work. This is going to make farmers money. And then of course they get to sell the seed, right? Yeah.
Because for distillation, you're looking for very high carbohydrate yield, and having only 400 corn heat units, that much carbohydrate yield for
Well, all we have to do is compete with the other crops though, right? Yeah. It is about that. Yeah. I'm not a corn expert. This is everything I know about corn's happened in the last 4 months, but we're looking forward to learning a lot more over the next 3 years on this project. This project was funded solely by Acid F2, I wanted to mention, so that's a great fund.